All right, good afternoon, everybody. It's a little bit after 3:30, and we have had such an amazing day. American Percussion Seminar, Tuesday, June the 8th. And this morning we had our session, a student-to-student session, which was simply outstanding. And then Quincy Davis gave us so many wonderful things to consider about our playing and about how we might be able to coordinate and our improvisation and how to open our ears up when we're listening on stage. And of course, some of the basics of drum set. And now we've got Drew Tucker. And Drew has been on the UNT campus at least twice, two or three times, and always really just a wonderful opportunity to hear him talk about his music and about how he teaches. And he's just an amazing musician and person that inspires everyone he's around. So if you guys would please welcome Drew. Are you there? Are you ready?
I am ready.
Okay.
So we're going to...
Drew's got the promo shots happening here. This is good. Okay.
So I want to tell you guys about the worst gig I ever had. It was maybe 12 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, I'm not sure, but I booked this festival, like a street festival in South Florida. It was supposed to be like this New Orleans street jam festival. And to be fair, I'd never been to New Orleans at the time, and they asked me to put together like this street band, like this New Orleans style brass street band. So I did what I thought a New Orleans style brass street band was. After some quick YouTube research, I realized that it was like maybe those old like Dixieland bands. So essentially that's what I equated it to. Again, I remind you, I had never been to New Orleans. So we get together, we practice, I order some of these tunes, and we put together, you know, like the Charleston and some other stuff like that. And I'm like, this will be pretty cool. We're gonna be a street band. We'll be on the side of the street. So the day comes, I show up, we get there. I'm rolling my little drum set down behind me. I got my bass drum, snare drum, hi-hat, and a ride cymbal with my stool on a dolly. And I'm rolling up and everything looks pretty cool. I'm walking toward the end of the street where the big main stage is. And like, as I'm walking forward, I'm looking to the right and I'm looking to the left, and I'm seeing all of these really like quirky little acts going on. Some jugglers, some painters, you know, things like that. So I get to the main part of the stage, and on the main part of the stage, there's this huge band. I mean, like, totally hitting, like Earth, Wind & Fire plus Chicago. I don't even know, man. I think Bruno Mars had his band up there that day, and Justin Timberlake and the Tennessee Kids. It was crazy. I think Aretha Franklin was a backup singer. Anyway, so I find the promoter for the show, and I say, hey, man, where are we performing? And he says, oh, you're on after them. And I'm like, no, dude, we're not on after them. He's like, no, you're on after them. I said, there's no chance we're on after them. I brought like a tuba player, a trumpet, I think I had a banjo, and me on this little tiny drum set. And it was like a 50-foot stage, or at least it felt like it. So he's like, no, you're on after them. So we get up, and it's our turn to go on, man. I mean, like, these guys who were on before us had just ended. I think they just sang We Are the World or something like that. And like, people were like throwing babies. It was crazy. Like, everyone loved it. They were so into it. And we get up there and I set up my little bass drum, snare drum, hi-hat, ride cymbal, and tuba player. Anyway, what proceeded to happen was absolutely I almost forgot to tell you. A huge gust of wind blew in, like, as we started playing the first song, and all the music, because we were reading charts, went everywhere. So now you got a trombone player trying to play his part while grabbing and chasing music. Tuba player is knocking his stand over, and I'm just sitting there, chick, boom, chick, boom, chick, boom, chick. Anyway, since then I've learned what a New Orleans brass band is supposed to be like. And if I'm ever called to do that kind of gig again, I'll do it correctly. But I gotta tell you, man, that one taught me a whole lot. Taught me who my friends were, because the whole crowd emptied out. My real friends were still there. So you might be wondering why I had past me tell you that story about my worst gig ever. Like, the by far my worst gig ever. I've had some terrible ones, but that one was really bad. But the point wasn't really the gig itself. The point was really the fact that storytelling is such an impactful way to share. And when we think about improvisation, a lot of times we think about the scales, we think about the notes we have to play, the combinations of notes. I know there's only 12 of them that are kind of repeated in different sonic ranges, but in all honesty, like the millions and myriads of combinations of rhythms and notes and harmonies and when to play them can really feel overwhelming. And I didn't have a traditional jazz upbringing per se. I didn't go through transcribing a ton of things in university. I went into a classical cave for quite a while. So in a lot of ways, the things I'm going to talk about today are a lot of the things that I had to sort of understand. And when I was able to understand them in terms of my improvisation, a lot of things changed for me. A lot of the way I understood improvisation, a lot of the pressure of playing all these right notes, a lot of the pressure of where to play them and how to play them sort of cleared up for me. And that's because I realized something that was really important. And I realized that people now, when I say people, I get, listen, everyone's people, but when I'm talking about people, I'm talking about, I guess, what you would call a lay person when it comes to music, like just people who aren't music students or who aren't other musicians or colleagues. People don't come to hear me play my scales. Like, that's not why they're there. They're not there to say, oh man, I mean, there might be a cat or two in there who wants to come in and kind of say, well, you know, I love the way you played that, you know, tritone substitution. And I love the way you did those reharms, but that person is few and far between. And usually, if that's another musician, what I've realized, and I learned from a mentor a while back, he said to me, listen, man, don't ever play for other musicians. And I said, well, why not? He goes, because other musicians are the first dudes asking for comp tickets and free CDs. And let me tell you something that has proven true and true again. And as another musician, I also know that I'm still the first person asking for comp tickets and free CDs sometime. So I encourage other musicians not to play for me, but to play for people. And the one thing that connects all people, there's a lot of things, but the things that connect people aren't scales. The things that connect people are love and humanity and sadness and hope and loss and pain and joy and happiness. And all of that can be summed up and shared through the art of storytelling. So what I wanted to do today is talk about storytelling, like literal storytelling, and how that relates to improvisation. Now, I also think that cats who know their scales, I've seen a lot of guys go and play some crazy licks. They play some crazy, mind-bending notage, but they're not saying anything. And you maybe have heard people say that, like, hey man, he's not really saying anything though. And what does that mean? Well, essentially, he's not telling a story. He's not following the rules of storytelling for the most part, right? And now, so we're gonna talk about storytelling, but if you don't remember anything else, rule number one, and I'm not really even going to go into rule number one, but rule number one is do your best to be interesting. If it's not interesting to you, it's probably not interesting to somebody else, right? So hopefully, even if you're an advanced player, an advanced improviser, you can get something out of this from the aspect of it's okay to not play with all of your technical facilities at once. And it took me a long time to learn that. As a matter of fact, on some shows, I would literally just to practice, I would just play a solo with one hand, just to restrict myself from overplaying. And that's not to say that I have like some incredible chops, but I came up in drum corps, so they were kind of forced upon me, these chops. These chops were given to me. I did not ask for them. But unfortunately, you know, it lends itself to a unique set of challenges. Because as percussionists, we're, with the few exceptions, most of them lie within percussion, we're one of the only instruments that don't, one of the only disciplines, I guess I should say, that don't actually touch the instrument to create sound. We don't breathe into the instrument. We don't play the instrument. Even our foot's not touching the instrument. In terms of making sound, obviously vibraphonists use pedal. But we have this stick and the core and the yarn separating us. So we can theoretically, we can be doing this, we could be doing this, and having a conversation at the same time. And not, it's a totally different conversation. Hey, Mark, what do you have for dinner today? Oh, yeah? Cool. That's awesome. You know, and just be doing that and be completely detached from the music we're playing. When Ed yesterday was talking about singing, you know, he didn't have a lot of time to get into it, but one of the reasons that I think singing is so important is because it connects you to the music that you're playing and kind of bridges the gap between your hand and this mallet and the instrument and the audience. So I think that's really important, and that's one thing that changed it a lot too. But again, regardless of your chops, regardless of your technical facility or your knowledge of the vocab, you still have to tell a story. So we're going to talk about that. And the reason why is because all of this stuff here, you can try to memorize these scales and all these patterns, and you can do all of this stuff. And this stuff is important. I'm not discounting the importance of all of this stuff, but it's really just information. This is information. This is learning your syllables. This is learning the fundamentals of doing things. But what storytelling does is storytelling emotionalizes information, right? That's what helps you emotionalize the information. By taking information, I could have told you that same story about my worst gig ever and said, so I had this really bad gig. There was a band on stage before me. They played music and it was really good. And then we played and I wasn't prepared to play music at that same level of intensity. So we didn't. And at which point I felt the human emotion of embarrassment and guilt for taking the money for that gig. People left. I felt pain, somewhat lonely. Thank you. See, there was no story. That was just me imparting the information. It's the same level of information, but it's important that when we're telling stories that we take the information in improvisation, these scales, all of these notes, whatever we're learning, and we emotionalize them, and that we tell a story. Also, stories give color and depth to otherwise bland material. This is bland material. This is bland material. So the purpose of improvisation and crafting a great solo is how can we give color and depth to that material? So we're going to talk about that as well. And then stories allow people to connect with our message in a deeper and more meaningful way. And this is at the heart of it. If we're playing music, I think Quincy said it first. He said, man, we're not doing this for the money. We're doing this for the love. I know for me, it's important for a lot of reasons. And for you, it's probably important for a lot of personal reasons. And if you have not figured out why this is important to you outside of your ego and makes me look cool and I like playing it and I'm good at it, so I decided to do it, I definitely encourage you to do some deep digging as to the why. But it allows people to, it allows us to share a message, and hopefully we're trying to share something, whether we're trying to share something from a piece we're playing that means something to us, or that meant something to a composer, and we're trying to transmit that message across to the audience. But even if we're playing written music or we're composing music, we want to make sure that we're sharing the message that's trying to be shared in a meaningful way. And telling a story with our music allows us to do that. So we're going to talk about some main story elements now. And so there's a little graph that we put together. And this is essentially a story arc. Now, if you've watched a movie or you've read a great book or you've seen just a great scene, this is essentially the elements that make it. Like right, this part right here is a climax. And if you're when you start over here on the left side and you kind of work your way over to the right, the question is, how do you get up to that point and what's the process of getting there, right? So there's all these sorts of elements. And if you'll notice, it's not an even little mountain situation here, right? It's kind of takes a longer time to get to the climax and then it goes down. The climax usually happens closer to the end of your story. And of course, all of this is negotiable, but we're gonna talk about the basics. So the first part is exposition. In a regular story, you'd establish your characters, you'd world build, and then you'd have some sort of conflict. And this is where the characters would they'd find a conflict that they have, something that they have to work against. They build a little tension, and then you have the rising action. And here's where the characters interact with that conflict. They change, they grow, they meet challenges. There's tension here, and then you reach your climax. And at the climax of the point, this is the most exciting point. And the exciting point doesn't have to be this big point. It could be a low point, could be whatever you decide for it to be, but this is where you're leading to. And then from there, you lead out to what's called falling action. And again, the falling action happens usually in stories, happens way quicker than the rising action. And then after you have that falling action, then you have the resolution. This is where all the characters sort of come together. They kind of, all the story points are tied up. When you talk about bad movies, usually it's because you're like, hey, what happened to that character? Like, did they just forget about him when they were writing this show? And that's sometimes what can happen. So this is essentially a map of a story. And how does this relate to improvisation? And this is what's key. So we're going to take a look at Simple Blues. I chose Billy's Bounce. We're not really going to pay too much attention to the melody, mostly because I haven't practiced it in a while, and no need to embarrass myself by trying to play that silly thing. But I don't play too many standards often lately, but I love this melody. But we're just going to take the progression of Billy's Bounce, right? And so we're going to take that same idea that it takes to have a story, your favorite movie, your favorite favorite scene, your favorite TV show, your favorite book. And we're going to talk about how to do that. So the beginning, we have the exposition, right? We want to establish our characters. In this case, we're going to call characters our notes. So here's where it becomes a challenge. Here's where people will look at improvisation and say, oh man, listen, I don't know what notes to play for this. So we're going to take two tunes. We're going to start with this one, and we're going to give a certain specific set of notes. Now, in general, if I have a piece of music that I'm asked to play, especially if I don't have a ton of time to prepare it and it's somewhat challenging, what I'll do is I'll find the notes that work, as many common tones that work within all, as many chords as I can. So oftentimes you'll see there'll be, usually if you're, and I wanted to call this clinic getting through the gig, like improvisation for people who don't improvise. Because usually if you're called to do a gig, like, all right, hey, I know you got a vibraphone, I need a player for this wedding. You know, the wedding is this, we're gonna play a couple standards, I'll send you a couple of tunes we're gonna play. They're not calling giant steps, you know, they're not calling tunes that are just switching key centers all over the place. They're calling usually basic Cole Porter type tunes, standards, things that tend to be in a central key center. Maybe they move once or twice, but essentially they stay relative to that key. And so what I like to do is find notes that work with all of them. And then I like to loop over them. I'll play the bass note and I'll play them and I'll listen. And now I know the rules of what to play and what not to play, but I'll listen to, and I'll create musical ideas and things that I like to do. So for this Billy's Bounce, our characters are gonna be the F major blues scale. These are our characters, right? So F major blues scale is F, G, A flat, A, C, and D. So you have the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 notes. You can use them anywhere in any octave that you want to play them in, but these are the 6 notes. Now, are there other notes that might work better with some of these chords, especially with your 2-5 turnarounds, like the C, those ends of the lines there? Sure, there are. But again, we're talking about how to make a story. So the best thing to do is to confine yourself to a few notes and work on your storytelling. A brief story for you, actually, about that. A few years back, I think Emily, my daughter, was about 7 or 8 years old. She started playing some vibes, and we were playing Blue Monk. And so I taught her the thirds and sevenths of the chords and when to play them. And Emily has a great ear, so she quickly picked up on the thirds and sevenths. She was playing, it was B flat, right? So it's third and sevenths. Then it goes to, right? So we were playing all of this kind of action. Right. And so she's like playing these little things on the thirds and sevenths, and she's going through the 2-5-1s. I was super stoked. So I sent it to my friend Stefan Harris. I said, dude, check out Emily doing this. I'm expecting him to be like, hey, man, that was so great. Can't believe it. It's going to be amazing. He did not do that. As a matter of fact, what he did was he called me up. He said, man, that's cool. He goes, but, you know, she has all her life to learn theory and thirds and sevenths, and she has all her life to do that stuff. And she'll be older. She probably can't even grasp what you're telling her right now. Maybe it might be more beneficial just to help her find her swing. Just give her a couple notes to work with, 3 or 4 notes, and just help, just see where her swing is and help her to develop her swing. And that stuck with me. That was maybe, I guess she's 16 now, almost 17. She was 8, so that's like 8 years ago now. And that stuck with me. And so that's a lot of where this sort of thing kind of comes from. So the F blues scale, if you have instruments, you know, right? Now, even though these are your characters, some of these characters work better over some of these chords than others. Now, I could tell you the rules of which chords it should be, but if you listen and you take a little time and you play through it, you'll start to hear them. And so what we're going to do is we're going to play a little bit of it. Actually, I think I'm out of order slightly. Yeah, I am. So here's how we're going to develop the story. You want to use some of these elements here. Long phrases. Long phrases, right? What does that mean? Well, it means that your idea should be the same way you would write a sentence. If you've ever seen a youth write a youth, if I watch my daughter write sentences, it's like, I went to the pool. We had fun. It was great. My dad is the coolest ever. I may have made that last one up. And then, you know, she might say something like that. Whereas as she gets older, or as I've watched my other daughters get older, sentences get more complex. They get longer. Stories get more involved. They understand a little bit more of exposition. They understand a little bit how to say things. So as you're preparing this, think long phrases. So how do you do that? What's something to stay away from? So you want to stay away. I'm going all out of order. Told you. So tension and release is also the second thing. So those are the two elements. You want long phrases and tension and release. If you can take your characters, these notes in the blues, F major blues scale, and create long phrases and build tension and release, just like you would in a story with that rising action, you're going to be able to tell a good story, even with a limited amount of vocabulary. All right, so long phrases. Here's some ways to get into it. Don't end each four-bar phrase. You're going to feel like you want to end each four-bar phrase sometimes. And especially, just like Ed was saying yesterday, don't end them on the root note. The root note is like your romantic lead. He will get his love interest, right? But how he gets his love interest is what makes it interesting. Was there conflict? Was there a moment when they just missed each other on the road? When they thought, was it Romeo and Juliet style? How is he going to get there? The F will happen. You'll play an F. You'll resolve on F at some point. But how you get there is what's most important, right? So don't end each four-bar phrase. And I'll demonstrate some of that in a moment. But don't do that, and make sure that you kind of, the root note is something that you use sparingly and something that you kind of ground. It's like your home base, right? Your romantic lead. And also think about the overall arc of your story. What are you trying to say? Where are you trying to say it to? And this is where what Quincy said, and I love that I went on after a couple geniuses because I get to reference them and then thereby sound like a genius myself. This is where what Quincy said is so important in understanding the form, listening to the form, making sure that even if you picked it up in the middle, that you can hear where it is, where you picked up in the music. So let's play a little. Oh, never mind. I'm all out of order here. All right, tension and release. There we go. Now I see my little outline now. Tension and release. How do we build tension and release? Then we're going to play a little. All right, so tension and release, you can build it rhythmically, right? So you can use lots of space. That's always tension filled, right? People are like, when's he going to play next? Is he, you know, if you listen to, I think it was So What, So What that we got to hear a couple times with Ed and Quincy, and it was like, bung, ba-da-da. Ba-da-da-dee-da-da-da, right? It was just all of the space. Miles Davis is exquisite at using space. And use that rhythmic space, or use no rhythmic space, right? Which means when you do start to use space, it kind of releases that tension. But that one's a little bit more tricky and can tend to go wrong a little bit quicker than using lots of space. Especially if you're not super familiar with the chord changes. And then use rhythmic repetition. And when you're using rhythmic repetition, it not only develops the theme, but as the chords change, people start to wonder and listen in to wonder when you're going to break that repetition. So using that rhythmic repetition is great. Also, you can do the same thing harmonically. Your note choices will build tension. Wrong notes build lots of tension. Especially if you stay on them and you convince people that they're right notes, and then you resolve. Essentially, and I'm going to tell you this, I don't know if I should say this. This is like a cheat code. Essentially, and take me with a grain of salt, because there's definitely ways that this can go wrong, but essentially, you could play wrong things as long as you resolve with some authority. And this is true as long as you're doing it on purpose and you're not doing it like, I'm just playing wrong stuff because I have not looked at this, haven't worked on it. But if you make a choice to play some wrong notes and then resolve them, usually you can do that at chromatic, because usually, I think, was it Miles Davis said, you're only a half note away from the right note. You can do that. So you can, your note choices can do it. Melodic repetition, as the chords change, also builds that tension. All right, so we'll play some Billy's Bounce. Let's talk about long phrases. Thank you. Sorry about the little feedback there. I didn't turn off my mic when I started to play. So that was some ways, and if you guys kind of noticed, there was some nice long phrases. I didn't use any other notes. I didn't use any chromatic passing tones. I didn't use any other things, but there were some other things that I did to be able to build interest. And I said, like, if you forget all of this stuff, the key is to be interesting. And when you relate what you're saying, how you speak, to how you play, it's way easier to be interesting. And if you think about it, there's all sorts of times when if you're trying to tell someone a secret, you talk like this, you lean in like this, you say things like this. If it's really important, you say it, you mean it, you focus on the consonants. Sometimes you rise up, I couldn't believe it. It was so amazing. And then maybe there's some disappointment. And if you think about these things can be related to our touch, our accents, our different tone qualities. It can be related to if we decide to play more explosively, play dynamically, different articulations, right? These things can create interest in using these things. So even if you're playing some wrong notes, if you're playing with interest, it's going to be important. It'll happen. We're going to talk about theme and repetition, but I'm going to play some short phrases this time. And I just kind of want you guys to hear the difference. And then after we get through this, we'll play it a different way so you guys can hear those different things. And again, we're using the same characters. The goal is to build this all the way. And we're using some different characters here. And we're trying to help all those characters, meaning all of those notes, to interact with each other in a way that builds them up to this final moment. So here, check it out again. I'm going to do some short phrases. And let me know if you guys hear the difference. So right away, and again, I forgot to turn off my microphone before I played, so you guys were getting like double instrument. So what did you guys? It wasn't as enjoyable. It actually wasn't terrible, right? Like, but it wasn't. You were bored. You know what I mean? Like, it literally is like saying I had a bad gig. The gig was bad. It was very bad because of the following reasons. Number one, the gig was bad. Number two, I wasn't ready. Number three, it wasn't fun. Number four, people left and it was embarrassing. Thank you. That's essentially what you're doing. You're just saying these really quick sentences. There's no interest. You're not developing anything over time. When I'm arranging I arrange a lot for marching front ensembles. One of the things I do whenever I arrange is I go and ask the brass arranger, hey man, where's your level 10 moment, right? Because this relates to composing too. Where's the moment that you want people standing up and crying? Like, tell me that moment when people got the chills. And they tell me where that moment is, and I say, cool. And they try to tell me another one of those moments. I said, no. We have one of those moments. We have level nines, but I want to know where that level 10 is, because that's going to help me to realize the size of gongs I have to bring, the bass drums I got to throw in there, the cymbal colors I got to have. You know, if you tell me it's a level 8, maybe I'm only using one concert bass drum. Maybe I'm only using the smaller gong instead of the bigger gong. But I want to know where that level 10 is. And when you're playing, say it and think about that moment. Craft it, especially if you have time to work on it. I'm going to do this one more time before we kind of talk about it a little bit together. If you have questions, you have some things to do. And we still have a few more things, and we have some examples. And we're going to actually take this into a piece that's more of a longer standard, something with an AABA form. So you can understand how to take this. You may say, well, this is great for a blues, Drew, but what about X song or this song? Does this still work? So we're going to talk about that too. So I'll play it one more time. We'll sort of try to develop something, and we'll see. We'll stay curious. We'll try some things, all right? All the same characters. Thank you. my God, that was so amazing. So to be honest, I would have stopped that solo a long time ago, but I think I just had this one loop for like 8 or 9 times. I would never have gone, I probably would never have gone that long. So what kind of differences did you notice? What kind of things, maybe if you have any questions or some things you noticed about it, some observations, any way that maybe, or if there's something that you're just like, wait, that's not really connecting with me. Now keep in mind, I really wanted to do something special for this one. And I've been working on this idea of how to communicate this. So this is the first time I've actually given this as a formal clinic. So any questions you have only helps me as well, helps me to prove these theories or figure out some ways that I might be able to adjust it. So let me know. I appreciate the comments, questions, concerns, documents, briefs.
I'll speak up first. In my mix out here, Drew, it seems like the backing track is, it could be a little less, you know, so we can hear the instrument a little bit more.
Easy. Thanks. Yeah. Done. Already done.
And then I think I just want to reiterate your point because the keyboard went away, you know, with the blue, with the F blues here, but Drew is only playing the notes from that one scale for all of this, for the Billy Bounce chords, correct?
Yep.
Yeah. So he's only using that, and you're guiding them to make choices on tension and release by their ear only, correct?
Yeah. I mean, as you start to learn it, you know, it's the best way is to start with your ear. I always believe that. And then if you know the rules, like for example, in that F blues scale, the A is the third of F7, but it's not in the B flat 7. It becomes an A flat, which is where that chord changes. So the A flat works, but the A doesn't in some of them. And then the A works and the F doesn't. Now, if you're in the C minor to that C minor to F7, the C minor, well, you have a C there, you have a D there, that works, the F works, the G works, right? And those work, but you know, you wouldn't really throw in the E. Actually, you don't throw in an E anyway, sorry. You wouldn't really throw in the A flat necessarily over the C minor, but you learn that as you play it, if you're like, whoa, that wasn't it. Cool. Next time I go around, I'm going to leave that note out. And then it's this way of discovery that helps you to really understand and appreciate a tune as opposed to checking it out and being like F7, B flat 7, F7, C minor, F7, B flat 7, B diminished 7, F7, A, D. You know what I mean? And then trying to do it like that is just a much, you won't remember it. It doesn't internalize as quickly that way. Not to say you can't be done, but thinking specifically about really just being able to communicate something and tell that story, that's really kind of what we're talking about. Do me a favor, Professor, can you do a quick sound check with this really quick, just to make sure that it's coming through?
Sure.
The way it should be? Thanks. I didn't do that beforehand.
Okay. You might have gone a little too far down on the backing track, yeah. Did you hear that? Yeah. Now, Drew, that might just be my computer and my phones. I mean, everybody else may think it was awesome, but for me, it was a little too hot on the backing track.
All right, cool. Well, I mean, hey, I'll take that. I appreciate it. So hopefully that'll make it more enjoyable for everyone. Anybody else have anything before we kind of move on? So you guys definitely heard the difference between those short phrases, right? Now, one thing that I also worked on doing was trying to, and it was a little bit challenging for me to stay within those notes on this because there's certain things my hands just want to do. So I would go to do something and be like, oh, crap, can't play that note. And then it would kind of be a little janky. So, but that also helps me too. It helps me to quiet down. It helps me to slow down and to sort of think about the ideas that I'm creating instead of focusing on licks, right? Like I have a couple 2-5-1 licks that I sort of like to play whenever I get to some things. And it can get kind of repetitive when you play things like a blues that you've played a lot, especially if you have a rhythm section behind you that's playing like this track is, which actually as a track goes, these are genius jam tracks, which are a little bit, you can do a lot of things. You can up the rhythmic complexity of them. You can up the harmonic complexity of it. So I'm kind of in the middle here. So it kind of gives me a little more to work with, but yeah, sometimes you have a rhythm section that's just phoning it in. You get one of those brunch gigs, just kind of phoning it in and you're trying to be interesting. So this can kind of help you to still be able to create that story. And there's a lot of things we're not really getting into here, like feeding off of rhythm section, playing, you know, what ideas are the rhythm section giving you? What ideas are the piano player giving you that can inform what you're going to play? And these things sometimes happen simultaneously, and I recommend you go for them. And if they're not the thing, that's okay. At least you gave it a shot, and then you can give it a shot again next time. All right, so we're good on this. We're going to kind of move forward. If you have any questions, feel free to just jump in, interrupt, and sort of say what's up. So one of the questions that I get sometimes, is when I talk about this, like in person, is, well, okay, that's great for a blues, but what do you do when you have maybe a more complicated track? So a lot of the song, we're gonna use a song standard, it's called I Could Write a Book. And we're gonna talk sort of about how we can do that. Now, all right, so, oh, you know why too? Okay, cool. So when you're looking at this track, there you go. All right, so when you're looking at this track, basically this whole thing has a C tonal key center. Now there's a couple of different things. If you look at it right away, you can sort of see that there's A flat seven kind of goes off, the F sharp half diminished seven, you know, goes off a little bit too there. You know, you have the E minor, which kind of, I mean, the E and the A still kind of stay in that same C key center. And then we go back into the C. And then if you keep going down, really the spots that sort of diverge from it are, if I'm being sort of drawing a hard line in the sand, I would say that you have the A flat seven is like your big divergence, which gives the song a little interest. But for the most part, you could stay on a C scale. Now, does every note on a C scale work with every chord? No, it does not. You cannot play an A when the A flat hits. You can, I would not. It's a choice I wouldn't make. You shouldn't do that. But how do you figure that out? Well, you try it. And as you try playing through it, you sort of, and I'll tell you how I develop it, and depending on how much time you have, I pick three notes. And I say, where do they work? Or I even pick one note and just kind of play it through the whole form and see where it works and see where it doesn't. Then I'll add another one. Now, how do I know what key center I'm in? Well, it's helpful to learn a few basic chords in this process. And I think everybody here, I don't want to say that, but I think that a lot of us here through our development will understand, obviously, a major scale. But we'll also understand that when you see a seven, it's a dominant scale. And the dominant seventh scale, which means the same major scale with a flatted seventh. That's a mode, and I can't remember the name of the mode right now because I don't use it in my everyday vernacular anymore. But the dominant seven, I know Dorian minor. The minors, when you see like a D minor seven, is a Dorian minor, so it's the second note of the scale. So that's all C, but with different tones that are important. And then, but for the most part, I look at the last chord. You can look at the last chord in a standard like this. Look at the last chord. You'll see where the resolve is. You can look at the key signature. And then again, you can just listen to it as well, which is super helpful. Now, my goal with this clinic is to help you guys be curious. I want you guys, this is a good starting point, trying to just demystify the idea of improvisation, so that you guys can go and then say, okay, cool, well, why does that work? Why doesn't that work? Let me see what scale this is. Okay, well, I see why that doesn't work now. That doesn't work now because of this and because of this. And that's a lot of the process that I used when I was coming up and improvising. You know, it was question and answer for myself, like, why doesn't that work? And then I would go and do some research and find out why that didn't work. Well, why did I play that? And every time I was playing that, or I'll ask people, I remember when we were at UNT, I was jamming with Ed. I said, Ed, that lick you're playing. I said, I love that lick forever. And I keep forgetting to figure out what it is. What is that lick? And what do you play it over? Why does it sound so dope when you play it? And I'm playing it and it doesn't sound good. Well, you should play it over this. Perfect. Right. So it's a never. And because I've always been in that curious mode when I play, I'm never afraid to ask questions. Like, I've never stopped asking questions. Quincy Davis drops his YouTube. I'm excited. I'm excited because when he starts talking about how to swing, I'm like, oh, like I listened to so much jazz coming up that I get how to swing on the ride cymbal. I get the sound of what I'm supposed to do on the hi-hat, but I don't know how to articulate it. And when he said, man, put emphasis on the quarter notes, it's like, I never thought of that. Wow. And so now when I'm playing a song like this and I'm playing and I'm improvising, I'm like, this is what I got to lean on for the swing. I was just like 2 and 4, or I was just doing something that I feel. So now when I'm teaching somebody else, I'm like, hey man, hear how they're putting emphasis on the quarter notes for the swing? I learned that from Quincy, you know, and it's so important. And the great philosopher Lauryn Hill once said, everything is everything. So all of this stuff is so important to gather this information and to be able to apply it to what you're doing. There's not a single thing that I've heard when I was listening to Casey's clinic and I was hearing him talk about the different motifs and the different themes, I was like, this is exactly what I'm talking about. That Brahms is telling stories. So that was Brahms, right? I came in late to that one. But right, he's telling stories, right? When Quincy was talking about how to play the music, how to understand the form, how to create and how to craft and how to figure out sound, I'm like, telling stories is beautiful. And all of that stuff only further enriched my playing. Even if it's by a little bit, these things keep on building the blocks that make players great. So if you heard or you were kind of checking out through Quincy's clinic, for example, I would urge you to go back to that, take what he was saying and apply that to Schwantner, apply that to, you know, whatever piece that you're playing later. And I guarantee you those same philosophies, just like he was saying, will work. So let's get into it. I could write a book. And so I'm going to pick the C major scale. I'm going to start really simple. And I actually made this one a little bit too rhythmically complex on the playback. So, but it's fun. So we'll have some fun with it. Oh, thanks, Ed. I couldn't with your applause. No, I couldn't. I'm just kidding. All right. It was C major. I used all notes in C major, but think about the elements that we were using. There was tension and release. I used a lot of accents. I used a lot of different volumes. I used a lot of phrases. I tried not to end phrases. Sometimes I would almost end a phrase on that root note and I'd feel it and sort of keep going past it. And I want to say something a little bit further. And I just stayed curious. I would hit some notes and be like, let me wait till that one comes back around again. I'm not hitting that note again. And then as I was playing, I would sort of make those kinds of distinctions and sort of be able to figure out. And I wasn't even looking at the changes. And to be totally frank, I don't play a lot of standards in my career anymore. It's just, I'm not against them. I just not where I'm going. So I don't really, there's 2-5-1 sometimes, but for the most part, a lot of stuff is just, these forms aren't as used. I've never played this song, I guess is what I'm trying to say, in an actual gig before. So I just kind of threw this on here because I thought it was a good example. So I wasn't even really looking at the chord changes, but I was hearing it. And as something happened, and I was like, oh, that's that interesting chord. And every time it came around, I started to remember it. I wanted to play a G over it instead of playing the A where I ended up sometimes. And so yeah, that was kind of what happened with that. So that's some ways to be able to do this and to be able to create it. And do we have any questions? Because I'm going to move off of this and talk about sort of how to craft maybe like a solo, like when you're not playing with anything, and how to use these same elements and maybe creating something that's just you by yourself. But before we get there, I just want to know if there's anything you guys want to ask, any questions. And the questions don't necessarily have to just do with this. I mean, there's been so much information. And if there's any other things that you just are curious about that I might be able to add some value to this experience, and feel free to ask as well. I have explained things so perfectly well that there are no questions about anything.
you have all achieved enlightenment. I love it. Cool. Awesome. Awesome. So we're going to get into just kind of crafting a solo. Usually I'm a vibraphone player. I am currently in the keys and could not get my vibraphone down here because of transportation issues. And the vibraphone here is, it's unique in its quality. So fortunately I had a friend who was like, hey man, I'll bring down this instrument. And this is an electric percussion keyboard is what it's called, an EPK. Sort of feels and has the look of marimba, but something totally different really. So I'm really glad he did it and took a little bit of sound testing today, but I like the way it sound okay across Zoom. I didn't really get a chance to check it, but hopefully it's clear and cool. And I think the Zoom world it's uniquely fitted for this kind of thing and recording. And I'm excited. I'm going to use it on a show on along with a vibraphone because that's my voice, but I'm going to use it on a vibraphone with a vibraphone and use this and a mallet station and mostly just so it looks cool, but I'll play all of them. But I'm excited whenever I get to play something amplified already. Because we play a lot of hip hop and a lot of funk, and I have two drum set players and a percussionist, so it's just nice to be like, you can hear me, and we're not feeding back. I can play dynamically, so that's pretty cool. All right, so we're going to talk about developing a solo, and this is I'm going to tell you the process I went through, and this is a song. It is a hip hop song, and it's by the classic Western songwriter. It's called Lunas, and it's one of the hits that has been a standard in Western musical repertoire for the past 30 years, and it's called I Got Five on It. And I have enjoyed this groove. Like, it's one of those grooves that when it comes on, and you'll recognize it even if you don't know the song, but when it comes on, like, you just have to turn it up. Like, it doesn't matter what point of the song it's in. So it's something that I like to build on. It has a really cool and identifiable bass line. And so when I was kind of crafting stuff to it, I just sort of figured out what notes worked. I do not know. I have yet to actually identify, because I haven't taken the time to do it, what chords it's moving through. I just know what notes I like to play over it. So we start with the groove in the bass line, and then we kind of move forward from there. So I'm going to start to play. I'm going to just kind of sort of put it together, and then we'll talk about it. All right. So as I'm playing it, kind of identify where you might find some of that tension and release, how it was created, where you might find some of those long phrases, where you might see some of this storytelling take place. All right. Thank you. The logistics. All right. Some observations maybe. Some observations on that. And it's always really funny because every time I play marimba, I'm excited for like the first 20 minutes and I'm like, where's my microphone? I kind of want to go back to it. I'm like, these keys are raised. I don't realize how big of a deal that is when you play vibes a lot. So yeah, what did you guys notice? What did you like, and
why is this wire always on my way?
I was going to say, I definitely noticed the long phrases that you were talking about and these elements of tension and release that you were presenting earlier. They came across honestly perfectly.
Oh, nice. Really, I appreciate cool that.
Watch. Oh, nice. I appreciate that.
There are chats, phrases and patterns. Stretch sounds good.
Cool.
Anything else?
I love the tasteful musical space. I thought that was really, really effective.
Yeah, space is such a huge and underrated. It's like space can make you nervous. Like you should, you know, I tell any music students, I said, if you want to be successful in music, you have to have a great relationship with criticism. You have to have a good relationship with jazz when it comes to a great relationship with space. And you have a great relationship with wrong notes. That you have to have a wonderful relationship with, like, and one thing I've trained myself to do when I hit a wrong note, I try to be curious and be like, huh, that was interesting. What an interesting character development that we have here going on. I wonder where this character is going to go. And I literally think of it that way. And I say, I wonder what I can do with this. I wonder how I can use that mistake to then continue to springboard other characters' decisions. And now this was all spurred on. Like this whole line of thinking was spurred on because over quarantine, that's kind of been me and my daughter, my 16-year-old, literally have watched a movie a night or binged shows every single night over quarantine when there was nothing else to do. And I got so heavy into, why do I like this movie? And why is this movie terrible? Like, why is Captain Marvel a terrible movie and Iron Man 1 a great movie? Well, it's because Captain Marvel doesn't grow, doesn't have to change, and doesn't have to do anything. Everybody's just laid bare for her. She's super overpowered and everybody kills her. I'm like, all right, great, whatever. Move on, wasted my 2 hours. Like, there was no interest. The character didn't develop. There was no crescendo to it. It was just, you'll like it because it's Marvel, right? So. When we think about the movies that we love, that's what happens. So I started this work on screenwriting, and I have a cousin who's she makes a good living at screenwriting, which is what she does. And I called her and I would be asking her questions about why these things are good and bad, and it just became a passion of mine. And as I started to play, I started to see the correlation. And sometimes it's a slow burn. You know, when you like those movies where where it takes a while for a character to develop. And sometimes also, by the way, I consider licks to be like those character tropes. You know, like the funny friend or the, the dumb jock or the pretty mean girl or whatever those character tropes are. When you play too many licks, that's essentially what I equate it to. Like, come on, man, that's what they expected you to do, you know, is to play that. Okay, here we go. Here's a Love Supreme in fourths. Awesome. You know, like, so, I mean, all of these kind of little licks that people sort of throw in. So I do my best to stay away from that and be as authentically me as I can. And I sort of realized that the more authentic I got, the more two things happened. The more I stopped comparing myself to other people, because no one can be a better me than me, period. Like, and that's not bragging, it's just true. You know, I'm just me, like with all my thoughts, experiences, pains, love, losses, good things and bad things. Like, if I can honestly bring that to everything I play, then it's me. And either you like it or you don't like it, but that's okay, because then there's somebody else who's them and you might like them. But there's enough humans. The scarcity mindset, there's not enough humans to go around, is not true. There are billions of humans on this planet. There are enough humans to consume what we have if we're authentic, but no one wants to see us try to be somebody else. They can go see somebody else who's doing it for real. I got friends who are killing vibe players, man. I mean, just crushing dudes. But if I try to play what they play, I can play the licks. I could play all the licks, but I can go and play that exactly. I can play Shega Desu Dauj. I have learned Shega Desu Dauj. I have listened to people play those transcriptions flawlessly. And I've heard Gary play it not flawlessly. And it was, you could so tell the difference when someone's playing something transcribed, no matter how clearly they play it versus when someone's playing something that they are playing authentically and is an interpretation of their voice. And so the more I was able to tell my story, the more I was able to relate. And that's why, my last album has Britney Spears on it, because Toxic was a guilty pleasure of mine for a really long, like, I love that. That was like my closet. I was in a jazz cave. So I would like listen to that one in the privacy of my own home, you know, like, oh man, you know, I'll play some Toxic right now. I just, you know, hey, what are you doing in there, Drew? Nothing, mom. You know, nothing. Just listen to some good jazz in here. You know, same thing with what was another one? Big Girls Don't Cry. Love that song. This is me. It's like being honest here. But I put those songs on my album because when I play them, they mean something to me. When I play Tears for Fears, that song I remember riding in the back of my brother's El Camino in 1986 when it dropped. You know what I'm saying? Like, I remember where I was when, you know, I first heard Roxanne. So those songs mean something to me. So I try to play, if I Got Five on it, means something to me. Like, it makes me feel a certain way. So when I play it, the goal is that I transmit that feeling or help other people feel something because I'm being honest. Now, if I go and try to sit here and play, you know, Lullaby of Birdland in whatever key and I try to burn it, like, hey, guys, let's play it at 220, I'm going to play it my way, you know, because I'm going to play it in the way that feels good to me. I'm not going to try to do all of this other stuff. And I've been in cutting up situations with other guys where I tried to play their game and be like, oh, he's going to play faster than me? No, he's not. I'm going to play faster than him. And then, bad things happened all around, you know? So I guess that's a long way around of being like, thanks. Like, a long way around of saying, that's why I like to use space. So thanks. Anything else on that?
Just to kind of go off of what you're saying, I love that idea of authenticity and being yourself. So how do you balance, like, you know, especially being a student, I know a lot of you guys are all students. How do you balance, like, someone telling you, well, hey, I didn't like that, or I thought I was bored or whatever, like, you're getting criticism from people. How do you balance, like, well, I'm being mean, if you don't like it, you know, go shove it, versus like taking the criticism or taking the feedback and trying to learn and grow from that? How would you kind of balance the two?
So, I guess I just kind of sort of started that by saying that one of the things about being a musician or a jazz musician, you have to have a decent relationship with criticism. It can't be a relationship that's one of combativeness. Like, you can't come, if you can learn to eat up the meat and spit out the bones of what people say, then you can always grow. So I had a friend, and this is a true story. He's working in a printery, and he was on shift, and I heard this from him, and he's like, man, I came on shift and somebody had left a wrench on top of the printer or some tool. I don't recall what it was. And there's huge signs that say, leave nothing on top of the printer, leave nothing on top of the printer, the thing that runs all the paper or whatever. Someone left some sort of tool or some object on top of it. They switch shifts. He comes in, tool falls in, blocks up the whole printer. Company loses some, you know, obviously you can see the obvious problems with other things other than paper going in. He said, man, the foreman came and just ripped into me. And I was like, but it wasn't your fault. And me, I'm just like, what did you say to him? Like, did you say, hey, listen, stop talking. It was that guy. He goes, nah. He goes, he got it out of his system. I apologized, told him I wouldn't, you know, hey, that's nothing I would ever do. I said, I'm unsure who, I tried to tell him I was unsure, but then he kept going. He didn't care. At the moment, he's mad because his boss is about to get down on him, right? His boss is about to get on him. So it happened. It doesn't matter if it was me or somebody else. He goes, now, if the guy would have tried to fire me, we could have had a different conversation, but he was just trying to tell, he didn't write me up or anything. So I figured, you know what? It was good counsel. And I was like, what kind of Zen Yoda stuff is that? It was good counsel, right? Like, I'm still angry for him. And he's like, you know what? I'll never leave anything on top of there again. I mean, I'll never leave anything on top of there at all now. I might have before. Now I won't. And I thought, man, that's a good relationship with criticism. He employed empathy. He said, this guy's going to have it hard. He's going to have to answer himself. He employed understanding, and he employed the fact that there was something in that criticism that was going to help him become a better human or better at his job or whatever the case may be. And so typically it's a matter of self-awareness. You know, if somebody comes up to me and says something that I'm already raw. So I posit that people can't make you feel anything. I cannot make you feel anything. I can't make somebody feel something. I can, however, say something that triggers thoughts and insecurities that thereby make you feel something, right? So if you tell me that, hey, Drew, I think you're a terrible father, dude. You know, I don't like the way you're, someone actually hit me up and said that my daughter shouldn't be singing Toxic. And I think that's terrible. I'm just like, okay, whatever. Like, I know I'm very confident. The narrative that I have is that I do the best that I can with the tools that I have. And fatherhood's something that I take, you know, it's my priority in life. And so you can't tell me anything. Like, you can tell me that I'm terrible and that I'm awful and that my kids should be taken away and I'm gonna laugh in your face. However, if you tell me that I don't really, really truly understand the altered scale, I might be like, oh, damn, called out. Do do not truly understand the altered scale. I've read it and it's trying to be explained and I freaking don't know. I fake it every time I hit an altered scale or I skip it. And that's where I employ space. Then I might do it, but you didn't make me feel that way. You're just pointing something out. My thoughts and insecurities on the fact that I just can't understand the stinking scale. Ed, please call me later. Help me understand it. But I can't understand the scale is the reason that I'm triggered this. So if that does happen and I feel angry or upset about it, typically I just go inward. And if the person was just being a jerk, like, because the truth is that someone can say, hey man, I'm just telling you the truth. That wasn't a good performance. Hey, I'm just telling you the truth. Well, truth without love is brutality. Truth without love is brutality. And love without truth is hypocrisy. So the fact is, if you're giving truth with love, you know when to say it. You care about how you're saying it. And if someone just wants to come up to me and be brutal to me, then, you know, I'll look internally and realize why it bothered me, but I'll also not talk to that person again. And I also I don't account them for anything, because why would someone do that to me? Does that make sense? Does that kind of answer your question?
Yeah, because I think that's great. I think especially when you're improvising, it can feel so personal. I mean, it's one thing to play someone else's music, and you know, if someone doesn't like it, you don't necessarily feel so accountable, versus you're playing your own stuff or you're improvising, and it can feel much more personal if someone doesn't like it, or if they want to offer you feedback like, well, hey, I think you should play louder, or I think it was too notey, or it was too whatever, you know, to kind of like be true to, well, I liked it, so...
There's yeah. That. Yeah. And sorry.
Go ahead.
No, I'm just saying there's also a level of me under, you know, when I think about, for example, I got 5 on it. It sounds good because my priority is always on the groove and the bass line. The minute I forget that and try to get fancy, the song sort of falls apart. The importance of that song, what makes that song is. Right. So if I'm always focused on that, I might sacrifice some stuff up here. It'll feel good and you'll like it. My point in all that is to saying, in my life, I have rules with how much I can practice, how much I can tour, because my priority is my kids. My priority is my family. And I understand the fact that I'm going to get as good as I'm going to get sometimes, and I'm going to go out and play and share, and I'm cool with those deficiencies. Whereas somebody else might be single, living at home, got a really supportive family, get to go run, and that's great. And my goal in that situation is hopefully to be able to support them. You know, if someone's going to go play vibraphone and they're single and they're by themselves and they're taking advantage of that and they don't have any kids and they're just, this is what they do. They're on tour 180 days. They're practicing 5 hours a day. God bless them. What can I do to help you get on? You know what I mean? Is there anything that I can do from my position to be able to help you? And that's where I can still be of value to my community as a whole. Right. So I'm cool with not being able to play certain things. So when someone comes to me, man, dude, man, I felt like, you just kind of just, I don't know, man, today wasn't it. And I know also, like, I'm pretty self-critical when it comes to that kind of stuff. I say appropriately uncomfortable. So, I mean, I'm usually pretty healthily self-critical, but only to the point where I know, like, yeah, well, yeah, I would have practiced for 5 hours, but my kid had a swim meet and my other kid had, you know, a concert to play. And I'm cool with that. And that's my life. And that's what I've chosen. And I've chosen it from a position of strength, not accidents. So, well, the second one was kind of, anyway, whatever. But that's the bottom line. So I hope that answered your question. So cool. Anything else on any of that? I mean, I love this conversation. I loved Robert's thing today on burnout. Absolutely loved it. And I think that's one of my keys with staying away from it, is knowing who I am and where my values are. And the only time for me personally that I felt burnt out is when I flipped those around. You know what I mean? Crud, I got to make money. Can't talk to you kids. Can't talk to you. What, you know, I mean, I got a tour. I got this 5-week tour, and I go against what I know to be my value system. And then I feel overwhelmed because the things that matter to me are falling apart. As long as I keep those things in their proper order, I typically tend to be okay when other things, the less important things sort of go by the wayside. But I'll tell you, but I love that conversation. I love everything that's happening with this. So great stuff. I got more. So should I go on? We have other questions? Cool.
I have a question, Drew. First off, I love everything that you've been saying and doing. Goodness. Wow. As always. And I think that question about confidence and playing, when you play, you know, you have an aura about who you are and what you're going to do. And that's what you're telling them, I think. When someone asks you, how do you create personality and character in your music, what's the answer for you?
Personality and character in my music. I think a lot of that, you know, people, there's always the conversation on what you do physically behind the instrument, like what sort of visual acuity do you have when you're playing? What choices are you making? Do you feel contrived? I mean, you know, are you... You know, like what kind of choices are you making? And I think that there's been times when I've started to get a little over emotive, and then whenever I try to draw it back or I care about that stuff, then it becomes contrived. So as long as I'm doing things that feel natural and good and are my way of expressing things that make me feel comfortable, then that's me. Yeah. The minute I try to worry about, like, I remember I had this gig, it was at Jacksonville Jazz Fest, and I'm playing, and it's maybe 5 years ago now, and I remember catching Andrea Vinay in my eye at the left corner, and I was like, oh, shoot. Like, and then I just started playing so many wrong stuff. Like, just because I was like, oh, she probably thinks I'm using too much pedal right now. And Andrea is one of my favorites. Like she has a great touch, and she's one of my favorite marimba players and somebody who I just really appreciate. And I don't like Bach, but I like when Andrea plays Bach. And that's pretty much, you know, that's, and when Pius played it on his album too, that was great. And I love that. So, and then I had to be like, whoa, 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 whoa. I'm trying to play for Andrea and now everything's going wrong. And for me, I have these fail safes that I've sort of created in my head. I have a certain image of my kids that I keep in my head. And I have a certain little thing that I say to myself that reminds me of why I'm doing what I'm doing. And just gets me out of, and I do that backstage every day. I do that backstage. I say some things to myself about, you know, my children are able, I'm able to have an abundant life and be abundant for my children because of the fact that I do what I love. And they're able to have permission to do whatever they want to do because of the fact that I'm able to provide, and they see me as a living example of what they do. Going out there and doing this provides just another layer of being able to share music, to be able to share with my kids, to be able to provide for my children, and I'm nothing but grateful. And I'll say that over and over again. I don't care. From that moment, I'm ruthlessly critical in practice, but I'm blindly optimistic on game day. You know what I mean? And then I can, and only when I saw her, and this sticks out to me because it was a rare moment, and she'd never been to a show of mine. I've known her for a long time, but, and it just got me all self-conscious and in scarcity. Like, there's not enough right notes. I can't find any of them. They're all wrong. And so to bring it around to answer your question, I think the more I focus on the why that I do things is the more authentic I can be and the more of me and my personality I can bring out.
Of course. I think maybe I didn't ask the question with the words. The words didn't say what I was thinking.
Sure.
What's okay. That? That's like I tell my students, don't do what I said. Do what I was thinking. You know.
Oh, yeah,
you know?
Of course.
Easy. What I meant was, like, how do you create that personality and character in your music?
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Like with sound, like sonically.
Right. Right.
Oh. Okay. Well, I have the great mallets by Innovative Percussion. And I say that kind of jokingly, but mallet choice really helped me a lot. And something that also helps me as a vibraphone player is sometimes just changing up how I hold the mallets and changing up the way that I do things helps me to ask more questions and approach differently. So there are times when I'll play with two mallets, and if I'm playing with a mallet that's too light for me, it's hard for me to create the sounds that I want. And this is not a plug for Innovative. I mean, I was joking about it, but just in general, playing with different types of mallets helps me to find different voices that and feel different when I play and have a different approach and a different touch to the instrument. Like, as a, you know, if I'm playing something that's too light, I have big hands, you know, and so oftentimes it'll just not make me feel right. So I find my personality a lot in, that's one thing actually I would usually say implements don't matter, but in a case of the what makes me feel like I'm creating a sound that reflects me is a lot of that. And then there's also a lot of me actually telling a story. Like, if I find myself playing too much, I will literally tell a story while I'm playing a solo. And that story reflects my dialect. And again, we're talking about jazz. This is a different application, I think, in classical, but I think in classical too, there's pieces where a heavier mallet just seems like it helps you sink into some notes, and it helps you to, and so choosing that, whether you use whatever company you like to use, I mean, figure, it's not just, oh man, I love these mallets, and these are mallets I use for everything. We have this luxury of choice. So even if your choices are limited, you know, be concerned about that choice, because that sound is going to reflect you and the way that you feel holding those things, and that feeling it gets off the bar are going to matter. Is that better? That better answer what you're thinking, sort of? Yeah, cool. Awesome. So I'm going to check the chat. Repetition. Yep. Phrases. Patterns stretched over the repeats. Love that. Agrees with Professor Ford. Sounds good. Super cool. All right. Awesome. Awesome. Did I miss anything? Oh, still a great conversation. Thanks, Lisa. All right. So I want to use an example. And this example is of a song. And this, to me, this is... This is probably, I would say, when I think of like a solo that goes somewhere and does everything that I'm talking about and creating a great story, this solo is it. And I did something different where I put this to two of my favorite movie scenes, if I had to pick them. And so I'm gonna play it. One of them actually has no words in the scene anyway. So I'm gonna play it over it. And honestly, I just dropped the solo in with the scene and see if you could see all the elements of storytelling as they happen. And so check it out. Oh, and the solo is, well, I'll give you extra points if you know it. Yeah. So, you know, that was an experiment I was doing, and that even surprised me that worked out. I mean, what do you guys notice about that? Is there anything that you observe there that you'd like to point out, or any questions about that particular, anyone know what solo that was? I mean, you get extra points if you know what solo that was, or who's playing it. So the solo is by Joshua Redman, tenor sax, and it's on an album by Chick Corea called Remembering Bud Powell, and the song is I'll Keep Loving You. And it came out like 96, and I got that CD from Borders Books and Music, and it was, I can listen to that solo over and over again. It makes me, whatever I'm feeling, that solo expresses it. I thought it was amazing how when you see it, and my goal with this is to help you realize that the elements are the same. Things that you already know, that you already understand, like a scene from, anyone know the movie? That actually wasn't my favorite scene, but I did appreciate it because it had no words in it. So it was really easy to kind of do that. So it's Love Actually is the movie. Classic. Yes, Terminator 2, actually. That was a deleted scene from Terminator 2, which they actually used in Love Actually. because they like to reuse stuff. I mean, Hollywood, right? So that was Love Actually. And it was, there was no words, there was no words in it, which made it really simple. And as you can see it, like you see moments where almost like there's a question and answer. When characters switch, you heard Chick kind of play a chord at when Keira Knightley looked up, you know what I mean? Like, and I'm going to play it one more time. And then I got a little more time. I'm going to play it one more time. And then I have another one, but you could see, and the fact that I'm going to play one more, do it with one more scene that does have words, just so you can see how storytelling is storytelling is storytelling is storytelling. And when you can demystify the idea of improvisation by realizing that all you got to do is tell a story, pick a couple notes that work, use your ears. And now listen, there are tunes that is much more challenging. I would encourage you to start with the blues if you don't have any experience with it. Take a major blues scale in that root chord. Or if it's a minor blues, careful. Funny story, and don't tell Tom Merrick I said this, but so I went out to Blue Coats in 2018, and he calls me up. He says, "Hey man, we got all this vibraphone stuff, and it's a lot of vibe stuff. I need somebody to come out and vibraphone these guys." And so I went out to Blue Coats, and sure enough, there's six vibraphones, and there's no pedaling and no dampening going on. So we did that, but then they had these huge runs, and the song was a major blues that they were playing, but all these runs were minor blues scales. And I'm like, can I change any of this stuff? Like, are you cool if I change it? So I had to change all of this stuff to like major blues. Because really, there's a lot, if you're young improvisers, you know, you like to use the minor blues scale pretty much over a lot of things. So just be careful with that. Major blues scale to me is way more. I think it's, there's not nearly as many minor blues as there are major blues. So the major blues scale works a lot more, and you could use it in a lot more places to resolve a lot of things. You know, that blue note Ed was talking about, which is that minor third. I'm going to play that one more time, and this time just so you know what you're looking at, and so you can like listen to it and watch for some of these moments. And again, I did not line this up. I found a solo that was the same length, I mean a movie clip that was the same length as the solo, and I dropped it in. But just see how storytelling, it always works. You tend to see the same things, the same elements of storytelling in a great jazz solo as you would see in a movie. One more time on this one. So right here, the rising action starts. And the more you watch it, the more you see these different things. Right there. That downbeat with her eye look. This build, this tension, rhythmic repetition. Chick answering as the character switches. Now we have the falling action. This sort of little swell of anticipation here before the resolution. And then we have the resolution, which is a question, leads for a sequel or for Chick to continue his solo. So I find that pretty cool. I have one more and I'll show it to you, and then we can kind of just open this up for some questions and answers. And again, like, you know, if you kind of get this and you're like, yeah, okay, I get it, or whatever the case may be, you know, whatever the situation is. But if you have other questions for me regarding playing vibraphone, I know somebody was going to play for me today. Was somebody going to play for me today? Was that what was going to happen today? Someone was going to play. I know I have a lesson with you today, Chien, but I think someone was going to play masterclass style for me today. I don't recall, but if you're up to it, that's still cool. I'm here for it. If not, maybe we can set up a time to throw it down a little later.
Yeah, that's probably would be best, Drew. And I can tell you who that was in a moment. But yeah, there.
It was a Friedman piece, I think.
Yeah, I'll have to look for it. But nevertheless, it's just because of time.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, it's cool. All good. Yeah, let's do
so
it.
I'm going to play one more, and then we'll open up for questions. This happens to be one of my favorite scenes in any movie. So. Another guilty pleasure.
Where are the belts for this job? Why is no one ready?
Here. It's a tough call. They're so different.
Something funny?
No, nothing's, you know, it's just that both those belts look exactly the same to me. You know, I'm still learning about this stuff and,
This stuff? Oh, okay, I see. You think this has nothing to do with you. You go to your closet and you select, I don't know, that lumpy blue sweater, for instance, because you're trying to tell the world that you take yourself too seriously to care about what you put on your back. But what you don't know is that that sweater is not just blue, it's not turquoise, it's not lapis, it's actually cerulean. And you're also blithely unaware of the fact that in 2002, Oscar de la Renta did a collection of cerulean gowns, and then I think it was Yves Saint Laurent, wasn't it, who showed cerulean military jackets? I think we need a jacket here. And then cerulean quickly showed up in the collections of 8 different designers. And then it filtered down through the department stores and then trickled on down into some tragic casual corner where you no doubt fished it out of some clearance bin. However, that blue represents millions of dollars and countless jobs. And it's sort of comical how you think that you've made a choice that exempts you from the fashion industry when in fact, you're wearing a sweater that was selected for you by the people in this room from a pile of stuff.
Oh, this reset. That was weird. Sorry. Didn't know I was going to do that. You know, I mean, can we just talk about Meryl Streep for a second? I mean, come on. All right. Anyway, but what is one of my favorite movies anyhow? But again, I just dropped it in. I found a soul. Fortunately, it was around the same length of time, and I just kind of threw it in there. I don't think it works as well as the other one, but I think, and there was no music in it, so that made my life a little easier also. But that is just one thing that I think is so important. Whether you have all the chops or you don't have all the chops, you know, if you're playing a blues, if you're playing the blues and the blues is... That's fine for other musicians, I guess. You'd be like, oh, that was fun. He can play some licks, sort of. But no one's going to care about that after, like, the first chorus. You play all those notes all the time, and all those notes quickly become a lot of noise and rambling. It's like someone who just never stops talking. you know, oh my God, I just, man, I got this whole story I got to tell you. It was like this whole clinic, and I went to the American Percussion Seminar, but because of COVID, we couldn't really go to American Percussion Seminar, so we had to do it over Zoom, which really stinks because I really like going to Texas. And last time we went to Texas, we got to go see Paul McCartney. That was really cool. And every time we go see Paul McCartney, like I thought that it was like this amazing concert. Have you ever seen Paul McCartney in concert? Like, it's not the Beatles, but sometimes it is the Beatles, but it's like not the Beatles song, but he does his own song. But who wants to see his own song? It was crazy. But then there was this kid in front of me, and then there were these fireworks, and he was like, come on, right? That's just akin to doing that. So even if you got all the chops, man, tell the stories. I think it's something we don't really talk about enough. And listen, 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 listen. If I got a show, I have that stuff in on a playlist, and it's the only thing I listen to from the moment I begin working on it to the moment I got to play it, especially if it's somebody else's music. Because it's not enough for me to learn the tunes. I don't even learn the tunes. I probably, if I were to, on my schedule, when it's time for me to start working on music for a show, especially if I'm music director, I start listening to the tunes probably 2 weeks beforehand, and I listen to them when I jog. I listen to them when I'm home. I listen to them when I'm setting up my instruments. I listen to them in the car, ask my family, they hate it. Because like by week two, they're like, can we listen to something else? But that's because by the time I start learning the music, I want to hear every wrong note because I've heard it so many times. I don't want to be like, yeah, I guess that's probably right, especially if it's some really heady and notey stuff. I want to be able to know it. So listening is so important. Same way it is when you guys learn English, you know, your parents didn't drop books in your crib. Be like, here's all the important essential books, kid. You know, I'll lock you in here. Let me know when you got this English thing down and we'll talk. They didn't do that. You learned by trying, by making stupid mistakes. You were a child and you were speaking like a moron. Like you were talking really dumb. Dada. Like that's not the word, kid. Like get it together. No one said that to you. Oh man, he just tried dada. Did you hear that? You hear that? Dude, that wasn't dad. He was just spitting up. No, he said dada. That was it. So awesome. Keep it up, kid. It's the same thing when we're learning jazz. You go and you try it and it sucks. But you to yourself have to be like, I did it. I did something. Let's keep listening. Oh, I heard other words. Let me try these words. Oh, let me try these words. Here's some more words. Let me try those words and continue to grow and be there. But there's no way to shortcut that. There's no way to shortcut that. It's a language. Jazz, more than I feel, as much if not more, arguably more than anything else, is a specific language. You can speak it with your dialect, you can speak it with your accent, and you should. You should tell your story with it. But in order to learn any language, you must listen, you must try, you must fail, you must suck. Until you don't. And then probably you'll still think you do, but then you actually don't. And that's where I'm at. So, but just go for it. And just continue to try. Send it to somebody. Send me a video and be like, hey, what do you think of this? Awesome. What do you know? Great, man. Yes, you said data. Awesome. Let's talk about how we can now say mom. You know, let's talk about how we can now say dad is cool. You know, let's talk about how we can now say more things and more things. And that's how you build jazz, man. And then you take the tools from Ed's clinic, from Quincy, from the books that you like, from the things that you have, from the classes you have, and you apply them to your language. And then you, before you know it, I mean, we all improvise every day and we are all improvisers. Every time you speak, you don't have a script in front of you guys. Your question, Elisa, was improvised. You knew where you wanted to go, you knew what you wanted to ask, you knew the point of the story, but you improvised the question. You had the syllables, you had the main things, you didn't have to know the whole dictionary to ask me that question. You improvised the question. So keep that up, apply that stuff to your playing, apply the storytelling in your language. All right, questions, I'm sorry, I went a little over, but if you have any questions, please feel free to hit me with them. Hit me with the best shot. Nothing. We're done, burnt out, long day. I'm the last guy. Like, please stop.
Cool. Now there are some good things here because we have two question and answer sessions with our faculty. Like Drew will be available on those evenings coming up later, and he can talk about this amazing presentation he's talked about and gives you a chance to think about it as well too. So Drew, we can come back to it is what I'm trying to say. We don't have to they're going to have a chance, another two more chances to ask you questions.
Yeah, awesome. All right, cool, man. Yeah, I'll be in the house. I'll be here. I know everyone's got more questions for Casey though, because he draws pictures for music. So I have questions, and I got questions for Pius and why is Eriko so good and Naoko so good? I don't know. Well, so I got all sorts of questions.
It has been a fantastic day. I mean, every day has been fantastic, and. Really, as Drew said, the student-to-student was really just outstanding. And then, of course, having Quincy in the house and now Drew really complement each other and do what and build on what Ed was doing yesterday. So that's just a really outstanding opportunity. Now, tomorrow, we have the one and only Rainer Carroll with us. So this is super exciting. I have sent you an email with the questions that I have for Rainier. Now, I may have missed somebody's email or something because people were emailing my school address and my personal address and the group me and everything. So I may have missed one or two. So I want you to check it, but you need to check it in the next hour and then tell me if I've got it because Rainer's asking for them. So I want to give them to him, you know, very soon. Tomorrow he has a clinic. He may not answer every question, okay, but we're all just going to do our best with it and enjoy the moment, okay? And then after that, tomorrow, Fernando Mesa will be with us, and he is giving an amazing presentation about the history of the marimba. I can't wait for you to check that out. It's going to be outstanding. Let's see, what else have I forgotten? Oh, I put on your names and hometowns on the GroupMe. Tonight I'm sending the t-shirt order in, so if I've put you in, you're from, Cullowhee, Tennessee, but you actually live in Hawaii, you know, you should tell me these things so I can get it right on the shirt. I'd love for that to just check it, make sure I've spelled your name right and those things. I've already had a couple of very brief corrections. I've already fixed those, so no worries with that. Does anybody have any questions for me or Drew before we close out? Wonderful. Drew, I loved it, buddy.
So I have a quick, Chien, right? I have a question.